Okay, so this session of Applied Mathematical Finance is still around the sessions on interest rate structures. And maybe I shortly remind you of two little things. So first, a while ago, we were looking at the valuation of a floater, so pay a floating rate. So pay a random variable, pay a stochastic object at a future point in time. And we saw that this payment, yeah, this object and the time of payment actually had a very special structure. So it was possible to express the value of paying the floating rate at a future point in time a little t, in terms of just the initial values of these stochastic processes. So just in terms of the zero coupon bond prices, which I observe in little t. So we didn't even need it, a model for the SDE to express the value of this floater. And this structure was a little bit that we were paying an index, say here it was the forward rate, times a financial product. Here it was the zero coupon bond with maturity TI plus one. So the object which is one in TI plus one. And we discovered this structure also when we derived option pricing models. For example, recall our derivation of the Black model for the swaption. So actually the swaption was an option on a swap. So the swaption pays you the maximum of the value of the swap and zero. And it turned out that we could rewrite this in terms of a very similar structure, the maximum of an index minus k and zero, where actually k was the swap rate of this swap, multiplied with some financial product. And that financial product was here the swap annuity. So that was the swap annuity, which is a portfolio of zero coupon bonds. So here the A contained multiple payment times. So it encoded multiple payment times in terms of it is a financial product that makes payments at these times. And the special structure was that the queen object, so the index, is a martingale under the measure corresponding to the blue financial product. And another nice example where there was then a difference coming up was the evaluation of the quantor, where we suddenly paid something in an unnatural unit. So actually we had here a foreign currency value and we didn't convert it to the domestic currency using the forward using the currency exchange rate. We just used the conversion of the units, which was unnatural. But for this guy, we could also derive an analytic valuation formula. And this stuff, yeah, that sometimes you pay an index in a natural unit and calculating an analytic formula is maybe easier compared to paying an index in an unnatural unit, then leads to the so-called convexity adjustments, which describe the difference of the two valuations depending on these units. And maybe let me, so that were it was our last session, yeah? So, and maybe let me motivate this a little bit. So, assume we have a set of traded assets. So, for example, there's N, our numerator, there's M, another numerator. There is maybe a value process, so V. So these are traded assets. Okay, then I define my index as V divided by N. So that was actually also the case for the forward rate. Yeah? So V was the difference of two bonds at the beginning, at the end, And it was also the case for the swap rate. Yeah, it was the floating leg divided by the swap annuity. So we consider here the payment of X in units of M. Yeah? So at payment time, we have x of t times, the natural, the natural one is paying in units of n. So maybe I write here n. So at payment time, we pay x times n of t. Or we consider paying x in units of m. So I pay x of t times m of t. And recall that if we are in this situation here, so actually what we do is we calculate the expectation, we choose n as the numerator, we calculate the expectation of our payment, that is vt divided by nt. Okay, so now let's plug in what we pay. We pay x times n divided by n. So the n cancels. And I just need to calculate the expectation of x of t. And now x of t is a martingale under Qn. So X is a Qn martingale. And we have this this valuation, yeah, which gives us then that this is just X of CR. Okay, because it is a martingale. So that's the natural part. So that's the natural part. What do we do if we are in the unnatural part where we like to calculate paying x in units of mt? So actually we have two options here. We can perform valuation under the measure Qn. Okay, so performing a valuation under the measure Qn means I look at n0. Multiplied with the expectation under the measure Qn of what is paid. So x of t times m of t divided by my numerator. Okay, so that is I have x of t multiplied with m of t divided by n of t. So in this situation, we have that this guy here is a Qn martingale. Okay, so I know that it has no drift. Very nice. I know the SDE. This is also a Qn martingale. It's also something 0 dt plus something dw. Okay. But of course, the product is maybe not. Not necessarily a Q-Ed martingale. So it could be, yeah, if the correlation of the two is zero, yeah. So in general. It is not, yeah? Because I have the product of two stochastic processes and dW, dW is a dT, yeah? If there is a correlation of the two dWs. So that means you have to calculate the dT part and then take the expectation of the integral of this dT part. Or we could alternatively consider valuation under Qn. So we could move to the equivalent martingale measure corresponding to the numerator m. So what do we have then? So our universal pricing theorem says, okay, take expectation under Qm of the payment. Yeah? So we pay x of t in units of m. Okay, so we divide by the numerator. Ah, so that is maybe the choice which corresponds to when you pay. So what you pay, so the unit of the payment. Okay, that guy cancels here. And what we have inside the expectation is just the x of t. So I just have here x of t. So, but this guy is not a QM martingale in general. Yeah, so you see, I have a QM here. So either I have the index inside and not this ratio of the numerators, but then I'm under the wrong measure or under the unnatural measure, or I'm under the measure, yeah, here on the left-hand side, I'm under the measure that fits to the index, but inside there's also another term. So also on the left-hand side, you can cure this, of course, yeah, because you have inside the expectation, you have the x of t. And x of t is not a Qn martingale, but of course, you know that so what is it? We have x of t. So x of t is v. Is v of t. So let's look here. Yeah, I pay a traded asset, v of t multiplied with n. Sorry, divided by n. So I have x of t is v of t divided by n of t. Divided by n of t. Okay. Then let's add here an m of t and here an m of t. Maybe take the inverse of this guy here. So take n divided by m. N divided by m inverse. Okay, and then you see that you can actually represent this stuff as two QM martingales. Yeah, so this here is a QM martingale, QM. And this one is also a QM martingale. So even even under QM measure, you can express now the guy as the product of two martingales, and you can derive the adjustment that you have inside. And for our quanto, we choose actually the FFX, the FX forward, which is the conversion here between the numerator that belongs to the index and the numeraria that is actually paid. So that's the situation. So and I like to generalize this now. Yeah. So we had with the quantum adjustment, we already had an example for this. And now I like to generalize this a little bit in this way here. And let's see if we can calculate formulas that only depend on some basic properties of the objects involved. Yeah. Maybe the two numerias and the index. So we define this convexity adjustment, say, a little bit more general. So I just consider two different units I pay. And this setup, which we discuss here, is then useful for a very different situation. There is the in-arrears adjustment, which is that you pay at a different time. There is the CMS adjustment, the constant maturity swap, that is for swaps, you pay actually a different annuity. Yeah, it's also related to paying at different times. And then, for example, the quantum adjustment is also just a special case of what we do here. And this is then paying in a different currency. Yeah? So the setup here is very general, and it's always when you pay something in a different unit, and different unit can relate to paying also at a different time. So let's take this with the different time as a motivation. And first, let's recall again that we had the natural payoff where everything fitted perfectly together. So everything was nice. So our theorem 131, so the one for the floater, which I just showed you, stated that we can value the payment of the floater. And for the payment of the floater, I had that I pay here an index. This is the forward rate. And I pay it at a certain time. And this time is associated now with the zero coupon bond that is won at this time. So that lead to evaluation that only required to know the index and the zero coupon bond at evaluation time. So what did we do in the proof of this theorem? Yeah, sorry, small theorem. So we needed to calculate the expectation of paying this index. Yeah? So now I use the short notation Li for the forward rate for this period. So here I have some period. Yeah, so that is Ti and that is Ti plus one. So payment occurs here at the end. So there's the payment. And I pay this forward rate at the payment date. So I know the value at time ti plus one. So I divide the value by the numerator at ti plus one. Yeah. So that's the reason why you have inside the numerator the of ti plus one. Yeah. So this of ti plus one is associated with the payment time. Well, then I could actually say that I pay at this time, or I could say that I pay at an earlier time. So maybe this time here is called little t, or capital T. Yeah. So then I can also say that at this time t, I pay, and now let's take here this time t, in units of a zero coupon bond. So maybe I just remove this I here. Okay, and I pay in units of a zero coupon bond. And that's actually the same, yeah, because as long as the fixing is in TI, so as long as I'm after this point, I can give you the payment at any time just by multiplying or dividing with the corresponding zero coupon bonds. So we can actually move the payment date around. So now the choice was that we choose the numeraire to be associated with this unit in which we pay. So the choice of numeraire was here n. So this guy is canceling with this guy. Yeah. So I had here that this disappears from the expectation. Yeah, it will reappear in front of, because the evaluation formula has the numeraire in evaluation time in front of it, the expectation. But the numeraire does not appear here. And it's only the index that appears inside this expectation. And the second lucky thing was that our index is actually a martingale under this numeraire. So we could use here L in T0. So T0 is now the evaluation point. So maybe I have to fix the slide here a little bit. So this here is conditional to T0. So there was a small typo. So that's here T0. Okay, so I get the value at T0. So that was the proof that we could value the floater by just using the forward rate as we observe it today. And you see, for this proof, there were two properties here. The first one is we pay in units of this n. And if we choose n as a numeraire, then the index is a martingale. Okay, so we had two properties that gave us this nice result. They have to come together, so two properties. So the first one, the payoff is such that the chosen numeraire drops out of the expectation operator. So I pay in units of n. And the remaining term under the expectation operator is a martingale under that specific numeraire. So under the measure corresponding to the numeraire. So there was a special relation between what is paid and in which unit it is paid, yeah, what and when, maybe. So I call this then the natural payoff unit for this index. And whenever we have something that is not in the natural unit, we will get some difference, and this will then be the convexity adjustment. So what we consider here is the situation that we pay some coupon. Yeah, so I pay some coupon or whatever. And this coupon is a function of some index. So I consider here a function of an index. And I'm paying this coupon in units of some asset. And actually, I allow here that the time of fixing may be earlier than the time of payment. But this is just a minor generalization. Okay. So the payoff is given in terms of some coupon times an asset n. This coupon is some function, yeah, some deterministic function of an index. And the index is a martingale under Qn. So if I'm in this situation, then I call it the natural payoff unit. And if this function is linear, okay, then of course, expectation is a linear operator. Expectation of a linear function is the linear function of the expectation. So if the expectation here is, or if the function is linear, so then I can even find a model independent value, analytic value of this payoff. So if f is linear, I can find a model independent analytic value of this payoff. So now we had the trick that the numerator cancels. And now c is a linear function of x. X is a martingale. So I actually get that this is then just c of 0 times n of 0 is the value. Okay, and we have observed this for the floater. It was the forward rate observed in 0 multiplied with the 0 Cooper bond observed in 0. The 0 Cooper bond was the one that corresponded to the payoff unit, the payment. So we had this for the floater, where x is here the floating rate and n is this zero Cooper bond. So actually x is the forward rate. So maybe I have to fix a little bit the slide that here there is no argument. Okay. So x of t is then the argument, and it was then t I is the fixing. Yeah, these properties were also fulfilled when we derived the Black-Scholes formula, the Black formula for the caplet, the Bachelier formula for the caplet, the Black formula for the swaption. It was always an index paid in a unit, and where the unit was fitting perfectly to the index that is paid. For this option, the function f was not linear. But the other aspects were fulfilled. So I can compile a nice little list, where you are in this situation. And actually, it's surprising that much. Sometimes you read analytic valuation of something in a textbook, and it's just the same stuff again. And they choose a different numerator. Okay, why do they choose now that numerator and here they choose this numerator? Okay, now you know the reason why there is this choice of numerator, because the object that is paid is a martingale under that numerator and you pay in units of this numerator. For example, the Black-Scholes model for a stock. You remember for the Black-Scholes model for a stock, actually, there, our numerator is the object BT, which is exponential RT. And there was this choice of numerator, and then you saw that this numerator is deterministic, so you can move it out of the expectation. Okay, and this numerator is not one at payment time. But you can choose a different numerator. Don't choose exponential RT. You can choose exponential minus RT minus T. Okay, this one has the property that at T, so at capital T, the payment time, actually the numerator is equal to 1. Well, instead of using the bank account, I can just use another financial product that has value 1 at payment time. So why not use for Black-Scholes the zero Cooper bond with maturity capital T? Okay, and you know the value of this zero Cooper bond is actually in 0. It's just e to the minus r capital T. So the value agrees with what you see in this b of 0. Okay, so you can derive Black-Scholes formula for a stock again by using the numerator zero Cooper bond corresponding to payment time. And then the martingale that you consider is s the stock divided by this bond, s divided by p. So for an equity forward, paying the stock at the forward time, it is S divided by P. The function is linear, and you see the payout unit is actually the zero Cooper bond corresponding to payment time. So for Black-Scholes model, on an option, it's the same situation, but you have now here a non-linear function. It's a piecewise linear function of this index. And you see that many other situations are similar. The forward fx rate, so I would like to exchange at a future point in time one currency by the other currency, yeah, is has been introduced by us. So it is the fx, so it is the foreign bond expressed to domestic currency divided by the domestic bond. Okay, so you pay in units of the domestic currency this foreign bond here. Okay, so and an FX option is then just again the case where you have a different function. Okay, and our floater, it pays the forward rate in units of the zero coupon bond at the end of the period. Okay, and for our caplet, it was the same situation with just a nonlinear function. For the swap, we pay the swap rate in units of the swap annuity. And for the swaption, we could then rewrite that we have an option on the swap rate paid in units of the swap annuity. So all the stuff we did was the same, that we had an index that was associated with a unit and the both were linked together, that the index is a martingale under the numerator corresponding to the unit. So I now just define maybe natural payoff unit. So I say that something is paid in the natural unit if we are in this situation that we pay a function of some index in units of some asset, where f is just a function and this index is a qn martingale, n is the corresponding asset. If f is linear, I can derive a model-free valuation. It's just the index observed at evaluation time multiplied with the asset observed at evaluation time. So in that case, sometimes people call it a linear product. So if f is linear, they call it a linear product because linear products can then just valued without a model. Otherwise, it's maybe a European product or European option, where the word European here or European option in natural units, that refers to, so European refers to that it only depends on the single observation point of the index. So only depends on x at a single time. Yeah, other examples are Asian options, where you have the average of the index, yeah, fixed at different times. Or for example, American options, where you look at a certain index or value at a continuum of times. So I already gave you this interpretation here, yeah, with payoff unit and the index that is paid. So that's just a small summary. Well, maybe I have to be a little bit more precise. Sometimes I'm a little bit sloppy with the index and the unit. For example, if I go back to the slide here, you see that here, this has the unit currency. So it's one US dollar or one euro. It's the unit currency. And this one here is a financial asset divided by the financial asset. So it is unit less. This here is really an amount. And this here is an asset. Well, here below, I'm a little bit different, yeah, because here I'm paying something which has the unit time, and here this has the unit currency. So the unit is time times currency. And my index is a rate. Yeah. So the rate is actually one divided by time. So the product of the two is unit currency. You could fix this if you maybe say remove this guy here and put it here. Yeah, you could write here ti plus one minus ti. Then this is just the rate multiplied with the time, which gives you the amount that it's paid. Yeah, so how many units of p. Yeah. So you could fix this, but sometimes it's maybe nicer to have it on the unit. For example, here for the annuity, I would have to divide by, say, one divided by the whole span of the time, yeah, to make it an average, and then move that time here, and it makes things look a little bit strange. So for that reason, I often view the time fraction of an interest rate product as being a part of the payoff unit. Yeah. So for example, here I view it as for the floater, I pay in units of TI plus one minus TI times zero coupon bond, I pay the forward rate. So L is paid in that many units. If I have a natural payoff unit, yeah, so we already had this, then I have immediately a nice situation which suggests a very natural numerator. So N is now the natural choice for the numerator. So to value this value V of zero corresponding to the payment C times N in the future, I choose N as the numerator. It's the natural choice, and that X becomes a martingale under this measure. And I have this nice little formula that the numerator does not appear inside the expectation. And I just need to know now the probability distribution of f of x to calculate this expectation, this integral. If f is linear, I immediately have that this is f of x0 n0. In the case where f is piecewise linear, I can derive maybe a nice analytic formula. For example, if x is log normal, I can derive a generalized Black-Scholes-like formula. And if x is normal, I can derive a generalized Bachelier formula. So if you go back to where we derived a Black-Scholes formula or Bachelier formula, well, you saw that there was maximum of something, a linear function of the index, and zero. And this maximum function was just modifying the lower and the upper bound of the integral. And then we just calculated these integral parts, and that leads to the capital phi of d plus and the capital phi of d minus, because it was going from some bound to infinity. Yeah, so it was the capital phi of. Well, actually, if we have a piecewise linear function, you just decompose the integral into these pieces. You have a lower bound and upper bound, and you will get a very similar formula with a capital phi, the distribution function of the x, the cumulative distribution function of the x, at the lower bound, or something that depends on the lower bound, and capital phi of something that depends on the upper bound. So you can actually derive a very general formula for any piecewise linear function f, which looks very, very much like Black-Scholes formula. If x is log normal, and Bachelier formula if x is normal. So I have the example of a generalized Black-Scholes formula here. Yeah. So assume now f is not linear, but assume you know in addition that x is a log normal process. So it's a log normal martingale. So it's a log normal martingale. That means it looks like this. Dx is sigma of t x of t dt. Okay. Then if we have some piecewise linear function like this, defined on intervals from xi to xi plus one for my index, the stuff I need to calculate is the expectation of a piecewise linear function. So actually of a linear function on some interval. Yeah, so that's why here I have the indicator function. Yeah, so some interval of a random variable x where I know the distribution is log normal. And you can derive something which looks very much like Black-Scholes formula, where the xi and xi plus one enter into the lower and upper bound of the integral, and then of the capital phi of d plus and d minus. Okay, so I don't want to do this. It's just a straightforward calculation. But you see that in these natural situations, you can derive nice analytic formula for maybe already a very large class of payoff functions f. So here my f is a payoff function. Yeah, and now you can combine all kinds of piecewise linear functions. Yeah, I pay you zero. If you're below that, then I pay you something that has slope two. Then I pay you something that has slope one. Then I pay you, again, a constant. You can derive analytic valuation formulas for all these payoffs. So that was a small introduction, yeah. And now to convexity adjustments. So what happens if the payoff unit is not the natural one? If I pay at the wrong time, if I pay at a wrong currency, or if I pay something else? Okay, so changing the payoff unit from an asset N to some other asset M will change the value, yeah, if we value it. And this change in value is then called convexity adjustment if the unit is changed from the natural one to the unnatural one. So, and why do they call it convexity adjustment? For the quanto, they call it quanto adjustment, but the quanto adjustment is just another convexity adjustment. And the term convexity adjustment is maybe motivated very nicely by the in-arrears. So let's study a nice example. So the in-arrears. So consider the case where we have some tenor structure. So I have times here, ti and ti plus one. So I observe the interest rate for a certain period here. So I observe the interest rate here for this period. Okay, so this interest rate is fixed at the beginning of the period. So you see I fix it at the beginning of the period. And now I pay it also at the beginning of the period. So the natural payment time is actually the end of the period. But I just pay you this at the beginning of the period. It's fixed at the beginning of the period, so I know it. I can pay an FTI measurable random variable in TI. So I pay this at TI. So I pay it to some extent in advance. Okay, so maybe I would rather define this as forward rate paid in advance. But the name in arrears comes from the fact that we are considering this as being the rate paid for the period from TI minus 1 to TI. So for that period here, so I pay the rate that I observe at the end for the next period. I pay it for the previous period. So that corresponds a little bit to a fixing in arrears. So at the end. So, but of course, at the end, I can only fix the interest rate, which I observe for the next period. So assume you always observe the interest rate for 3 months, and you fix that at the payment time, so at the end of the period from TI minus one to TI. So this corresponds then a little bit to a payment in advance. So actually that's the same. But the name is in arrears because it is fixed at the end in arrears. And you also see it that here I define the time fraction that I pay is the time fraction belonging to this period from TI minus one to TI. But since this is just a constant, this is just a time fraction, it doesn't matter in the derivation. And actually the derivation is a little bit nicer if the time fraction is TI plus one minus TI, if it is the other one, but I don't care. So takeaway, we pay at a wrong time. So the natural time would be TI plus one. So this guy here would be the natural time, but I pay at this time, I pay too early. So what's the value of this financial product? Just apply our valuation techniques. So first, let's calculate or rewrite a little bit the payoff and then take the expectation under some numerator. Okay, which numerator should we choose? So actually you see here below, there are two choices. The numerator that corresponds to the payment time, so the zero coupon bond that is won at the beginning of the period, or the numerator that corresponds to the index being a martingale under this measure. So there are two possibilities. Before I look at this numerator, let's start rewriting here our payment. So I pay the forward rate for the period from TI to TI plus one in units of the zero coupon bond corresponding to time TI. So I pay it at the beginning of the period. Okay. So actually, since I have written there the fixing time, I should write the fixing time there, or maybe to fix the slide. So sorry, I have to fix the slide. I have to maybe, okay, so let's see. Here there is the observation time missing, Or is it missing? Let's see. Yeah, because below I plug it in. So let's fix this. So there should be here always TI and here also. So sorry for this. Slide looks ugly now, but I hope you still get the message. So I pay L in units of the zero coupon bond that is won at the beginning of the period. Let me maybe replace this zero coupon bond by dividing with the zero coupon bond that is won at the end of the period, multiplying with the zero coupon bond that is won at the end of the period. So this one here is then the natural one. So actually, I would rather like to have this guy here standing there. And you see, the change is that I actually multiply with this ratio of the payoff unit I have and the payoff unit that I would like. So this ratio, the bond that is one at the beginning of the period divided by the bond that is one at the end of the period, is actually just one plus the forward rate for this period multiplied with the time fraction. Okay, so you see that I have an additional term. So this red guy is just one plus the forward rate multiplied with the period length here. Okay, so just plug it in. So now I have the index with its natural payoff unit. So you see here, I have the natural payoff unit. But I have an additional term. So I have here L multiplied with 1 plus L. So I get L and L squared. So the thing is, I have here L multiplied with the natural payoff unit here. So that's nice. But I have another term. I have here an L squared. Okay, so now I would like to calculate the value. Let's take expectation under the natural numerator. Yeah? So now I had two choices. Yeah? So we could choose this numerator or I could choose that numerator. Now, if I choose the numerator that corresponds to the natural payoff unit, so actually to the one where the guy is a martingale, this one here and this one cancels. So I take expectation and this guy and this guy cancels. Yeah, so we choose the numerator that is one at the end of the period. But since I'm paying at a different time, so I'm paying not at the correct or in the correct unit, I now have a non-linear function here. I have L plus L squared. And actually the L squared also had TI plus 1 minus TI. Okay, because the ratio of the bond was 1 plus L times TI plus 1 minus TI. So you see, either I pay the index in the wrong numerator and I have a linear function of the index, or I pay the index in the natural numerator, but then I have a non-linear function. So I have a non-linear function. So changing the payoff unit is like changing the payoff function to something nonlinear. In this case, where I pay the forward rate at a different time, it changes from L to L plus L squared times constant. So in the second interpretation, where I moved to a different function, the forward rate gets an additional term, and this term is a convex function. X squared is a convex function. So actually, a convexity adjustment is even maybe a little bit misleading. It is an adjustment coming from the nonlinearity. It is a nonlinearity adjustment. Yeah? So it could be concave convex, or it could be x to the power of 3. Yeah? It's an adjustment coming from the function being nonlinear. So, but now you have some story why it is called convexity adjustment. So you see in the evaluation, I have this additional part here, L squared. So I take the expectation of L times period length. I know that this is just L observed today times period length because I'm on the right measure. I have the natural payoff unit, but I also have the expectation of L squared. Yeah, so I have the expectation of L squared here. Expectation of L squared is something that depends on the variance. Yeah. I know that L is a martingale. Yeah, so for DL equals some sigma of something, there could be some L inside if you like, yeah, DW. So I know it is a martingale, but if it looks like this, that guy depends on sigma. Yeah, it depends on the variance. It depends on the integral of sigma. So you see, I cannot derive a value without a model for the stochastic process because there is a nonlinear term. It depends suddenly on the distribution of L, while the other one just depended on the initial value of L. So that's the motivation why it is called a convexity adjustment. And you also have now a very nice formula for valuing the forward rate paid in areas. And recall the quanto. When we derived the quanto, there was an adjustment, and the adjustment was sigma of the FFX, sigma of the foreign forward rate, rho, the correlation of the FFX and the foreign forward rate. So it depended on the covariance of the index that is paid and the change of the unit. And here it depends on the variance because the change of the unit is actually just the index. Yeah? So the change of the unit from paying earlier is just 1 plus L. It's just a function of the index. So hence, it depends on the variance of L, the integrated instantaneous variance. So you see that's already very similar to what we had in the quanto for this in areas. And I can derive later a nice formula for calculating the value of this in arrears payment under a Black-Scholes model or Black model or Bachelier model or whatever. Okay, so let's derive this in a general context. So I assume now that we have a model for X under Qn. So I have an index X and there is a natural choice for the numerator, yeah, n, and x under qn is a martingale. And I can derive in valuation formula, say n of 0, which values this payment. So I pay you a function of this index fixed at time capital T and paid at time t star. Yeah, so for some T star can be after, yeah. So it doesn't matter if I pay after the fixing, because that will just be an additional multiplication with the zero Cooper bond. So, and assume I have this formula here. So I assume that I know Vn of zero. For example, assume you know Black-Scholes formula for paying the forward rate, yeah, at the end of the period. Yeah. And now the question is, how does the valuation formula change when I change the unit? So can I link the valuation Vn to the valuation Vm? So the question is, what is Vm of zero? No. When Vm is the value x times, or f of x times m paid in t star. So you know there are two approaches. You could calculate Vm by choosing m as the numerator. So that was what I did in my introduction. So then it is f of x times m of t star divided by m of t star, because I pay in t star. So it's just f of x of t. But maybe I do not know a formula for this expectation. I only know a formula for the measure being Qn. I know a formula for the measure being Qn. Or alternatively, I could write the value using the numerator n. So then I have here Qn. But now I pay f of x of t multiplied with m of t, and I have to divide with my numerator n of t. Yeah. So the issue is that I have something inside here, and I know the expectation of f of x of t under Qn, but I do not know the expectation of this product. Okay, so that's the situation I would like to look at. Okay, so the right-hand side I just wrote is just this. I can express the valuation of Vm as an expectation under Qn, but we have something here inside the expectation, which leads to some correlation covariance adjustment. Well, how can I now link the two valuations together? So I define Vn as the value process when I pay f in units of n. I assume I know a formula for this value process. And I define Vm to be the value process when I pay in units of m. So this means here I have measure m of f of x, and here I have measure n. Okay, so Vm can be expressed in terms of Vn. So it is an adjustment to the valuation formula that you already know. So how is that? So first, my Vm is valuation of Vm of capital T under Qn. And now you can rewrite this Vm. So Vm divided by n. So I know that Vm of t is just, I pay f of x of t in units of m, right? Oops. I pay this in units of m. Well, I could also just write here an n, and then I need to divide by the n again. Okay, then this here is just Vn of capital T. Okay, so there's always the capital T here. Okay, so it means I can replace here the Vm with Vn multiplied with m divided by n. So multiplied with m divided by n. And there's also this n here. So I can replace Vm divided by n, which is the one which is here inside the expectation, with Vn if I just multiply with the ratio m divided by n. So So now you see that this is the situation which I had in my motivation in the beginning. I have the product of two objects that are QN martingales. So here inside, there is a product of two objects that are QN martingales, but the thing inside is not a QN martingale. So now this here is a stochastic process, and I know that the value of the stochastic process at a future point in time is just the initial value of the process plus the integral of the differential. Yeah, so that's nothing special. Yeah, it's just I represent the value at a future point in time by the initial value plus the integral. It's actually the definition of the integral, maybe, no? Or the solution of the integral. Yeah, value at the end minus value at the beginning. So now I have here a differential of the product of two martingales. And maybe you see that is very similar how we worked for the quanto. I actually had to use Ito to calculate this. Okay. So, but I'm interested in the expectation of this. Okay. So there is an expectation around here. So I have the expectation of this. The expectation of this constant is just a constant here. So this is just the valuation formula I get if I have the natural unit plus the expectation of this integral. So the expectation of this integral is now the adjustment that I get to the other evaluation formula when the unit was changed. So let's calculate this expectation. So the expectation of the integral of the differential of the product of the natural payoff divided by the numerator, yeah, the payoff in the natural unit divided by the numerator, actually the valuation of the natural payment. Yeah, so that here is the valuation formula. And the change of numerator. So it's the product of the natural one and the change of numerator. So now, since these guys here, this one and that one, they are QN martingales, yeah, because it is a traded asset divided by the numerator. They are QN martingales. This part here on the left is just the integral of the differential of V divided by N multiplied with the differential of M divided by N. So why is that? So if you have D of X times Y, okay, I know that this is Y dx plus X dy plus dx dy. Okay, so now you know that X and Y are martingales. Yeah. So you know that this stuff here is also a martingale. It is a zero dt plus a something dw. Okay, so this here too, it is a zero dt plus a something dw. So if you integrate it, yeah, it's a martingale. So expectation is the initial value. So that integral over these linear parts, y dx and x dy is zero, no? Because there is no dt part. And only this guy here contributes, dx dy. So I see what I have to integrate is this term that I get if I multiply the coefficients in front of the dw of the original index and the dw of the change of numerator, very much as we did in the quanto. Yeah? So actually there we, this is now the sigma, sigma rho, yeah, coming up. Okay. So if I use this and plug it in here, okay. So I see that I have the expectation of this and expectation of this. So the value is n0 multiplied with the expectation. So 1 n0 here is vanishing. Yeah? So that and zero is vanishing, is canceling. So I have actually the value under the M unit. So the valuation of the payment paying in M units corresponds to the valuation in paying in N units multiplied with the ratio of the units observed today. Well, that's actually a trivial multiplication here because you could just change the unit from one currency to two currencies. If you make this change, this correlation here will be zero, yeah, because the dm divided by n is zero. It's just a constant, differentiated is zero. But of course, you have changed the units. Yeah, so that's just why we have this part here. So it is Vn multiplied with this ratio. And then n times the expectation of this. So I have this nice formula here below that I can express the value of Vm in terms of the value of Vn, adjusted here with the ratio of the unit change observed today. So in case there is a constant in the adjustment, plus this convexity adjustment here, which is the expectation of the integral of the two dt, differentials. Yeah? The differential of the index. So if we just pay a linear index, it is just the index and the change of Noumaria. And that we define now as the convexity adjustment. So let's give it a name. Yeah? So this difference that comes from the change of units is called a convexity adjustment. It's an adjustment to the valuation formula, changing from the unit M to the unit N. Later, actually, we have some more exercises. If I now assume certain stochastic processes, for example, log normal, I can even derive very nice formulas for these adjustments. So, and the Quanto adjustment, which we saw in this other session, was a very special case for this, where the interest rate was log normal and the change of measure was also log normal. Okay, so this change of payment unit is actually just a change of measure. So you have seen this, that I have sometimes looked at value under Qn, and then I had this ratio of the units here, or value under Qm, then I didn't have this ratio of the units, but this guy was not under its natural numeraire. And you see here from going from here to here, yeah, this is just then here inside. Okay, you have to take the initial values into account, the Radon-Le-Coudun derivative of the change of measure. So the stuff that appears there is just the change of measure. So you see here a little bit nicer, the change of numeraire is a nice tool to move to coordinates where you can maybe derive analytic formulas. Yeah, and so the change of measure is actually a nice tool when you derive analytic formulas. And I already made this remark several times, yeah, that our convexity adjustment is a covariance term. Yeah, it is the covariance term of the natural payment and the change of the units. When you remember the Quanto, we actually could derive a very nice representation where we reinterpreted this adjustment as being just Plaque's formula for the caplet, so it was the Quanto caplet, with a different initial value. Yeah. So you saw that this adjustment was appearing somewhere, modifying the expectation. Yeah. So this here can be interpreted as modifying the expectation of something. Yeah, it's plus something. So I can interpret it as a modification of the initial value. And then actually this allows me, because I'm so lazy, to skip the whole derivation of the Black formula and just use a modified initial value and plug it in into Black formula. So instead of thinking of the convexity adjustment as being an adjustment to the value, I can also reconsider it as being an adjustment to the rates or to the index that I observe. And well, this is nice, because then later we can also derive a very general Black convexity adjustment, convexity adjusted Black formula, for example. So let's look at the linear payoff. So if we have this linear payoff, so the linear payoff is I pay just x in units of m. So f is just the identity. Okay, so this means the value vn is just known as x times n. So vn of 0 is just x of 0 times n of 0. Huh? So vn of capital T is pay x in units of n, but x is a martingale under qn, so I have this. Yeah? So I have that vn multiplied with this adjustment here of the units is just vn multiplied with n multiplied with m divided by n gives me x multiplied with m. So you see that this looks that vm is just x multiplied with m. So it looks very much like we pay x in units of m, so for the linear payoff. But of course, we still have our convexity adjusted term here. But now I could just maybe move this term into the x by defining an x tilde accordingly. So what is x tilde? X tilde of 0 is the unadjusted x plus what I need to have an adjustment. So what I need to have an adjustment, if I multiply x tilde with m, I need the n0. So I have here n0 divided by m0 multiplied with the expectation of this integral. So you can think of not being the value is adjusted. You can think of the initial value of the index has been has some adjustment. So that gives now the definition of the convexity adjusted rate. So I can also consider that this adjustment is applied to the x tilde. And then the valuation looks very much like the evaluation in natural units, index observed at the evaluation time multiplied with unit observed in evaluation time, but now the index is adjusted. Oh, and this here is our adjustment. Okay, so sometimes you can use this nicely. For example, you can get a convexity adjusted Black-Scholes formula or Black formula, where you just adjust the rate inside this formula. Maybe we have later a few examples on this. So that is the general setup. So now I know that when I switch the unit, there is this additional term, and I have a nice interpretation of the term. It is the covariance of the natural value divided by the natural payoff unit and the change of the units. And now if you are in some special situations, for example, you know that both processes are log normal, then you can derive nice formula. Okay, and you can then see that all the examples which I mentioned, so here our forward rate paid at a different time, or the quanto, so the forward rate paid in a wrong currency, in a different currency, so in an unnatural currency conversion, or the CMS adjustment, which is paying a swap rate in a different frequency, different from the annuity, yeah? So maybe just once, like in the zero coupon bonds. All these guys here are just very easy special cases of what we have done, and we can immediately guess how the situation looks there. And maybe we do this in the next session. Yeah, it's just a few examples, and then we are done with the convexity adjustments. That was it for today. Yeah, thank you.